I was the first woman in Cameroon to be nominated Chief Justice of the Court of Appeal. And before I came to Arusha, I was also a judge of the Supreme Court of my country. I spent 2 years there as a judge of the Supreme Court before being elected to come here in 2003. When I came in 2003, the first case that I was assigned to is the Karamera case. And that panel was made up of 3 women. And that was the first panel ever of 3 women in this tribunal. It was presided over by the then vice president of the tribunal, Judge Vass, and then Judge Latanzi and I were members of that panel. We did the case, but halfway into the process, Judge Vass had to recuse herself. She had to recuse herself because the defense came up with some allegation that when she came in, she stayed with one of the members of the prosecuting team. So she decided to withdraw. So after that, they changed the complete panel and a different team took over and started from the beginning. I enjoyed my stay here. After that first case, most of the panels that I was in were presided over by Judge Mose, who was then the president of the tribunal. We did about 6 or 7 cases together. And then, fortunately, Judge Byron came, and then there was this new law. We said that ad litem judges could preside. So I was the first ad litem judge to preside over a trial. And at that time, there was a lot of pressure from the Security Council that we should come to the end of our mandate. So I did that trial in the record time. Period between the first witness and the end and defense and so forth, and then we did the trial. Altogether, during my stay here, I was in a record of 21 panels. I did 21 cases. I don't think that many other judges did that. There was one case where I presided, and I was the minority. I was the presiding judge. I read the judgment of the majority, and at the end of the day, the prosecutor appealed, and when the case went on appeal, my minority decision was the one that was maintained by the appeal chambers. So I feel really humbled that out of 21 cases, none of them was ever reversed on appeal. Another thing that I left here, the legacy, is that I was the presiding judge of the first case that was referred to Rwanda, the Owekindi case. It wasn't easy because before then we had rejected 5 other applications for referral. But when I was assigned to be the president of this channel, we looked at the case, we saw that most of the reasons why we rejected the first applications had been modified by Rwanda. The death penalty had been abolished. They had built a good prison. They had put legal aid in place. They had provided for protection of witnesses and so forth. And they assured us that they were capable of rendering the defendants that we sent a fair trial. All the same, we took the security to make sure that we appointed a monitor. And the monitor's duty was that they would be reporting back either to the ICTR or, in the event that we had closed up, to the mechanism, so that if there's any miscarriage of justice, they could go back and then the mechanism will listen to the case. And that's exactly what happened. I was here last month for that case, but before then, the president of the mechanism had assigned a trial chamber to listen to the motion. We had been doing a lot of motions online by email and conference calls. So at the end of the day, we came here, 3 of us, the judge presided, the president of the ICTR was the presiding judge, and then Judge Sekule and I. And since I was the presiding judge of the referral, they felt that I had a lot to say concerning that case. But at the end of the day, after due deliberations, we found that if there was any miscarriage of justice, it had been remedied by the Rwandan authorities. And in the referral judgment, we did write that revocation will be only granted as a last resort when all other remedies have failed. So Rwanda did everything they could. They appointed lawyers, which the man rejected. They still got another set of lawyers. He rejected them. And this time we felt that he was trying to obstruct justice just so that we could revoke his case, because an indigent doesn't have the right to say that they should give him the whole list of the Rwandan bar for him to make a choice of his own counsel. They had provided him a list of 64, which was the complete list of the lawyers in Rwanda who were willing to take the case. He still refused to select. So I thought that I and my colleagues thought that there was no miscarriage of justice. Rather, he is the one who was trying to obstruct the process. And then it wasn't even for his own interest for the matter to be revoked, because if we revoked, they are going to start it de novo from wherever they if they assign it to another court or whatever, the case will start from the beginning. So we didn't grant the request. However, we did say that Rwanda should give him the opportunity now to get a lawyer who could now recall the witnesses that had testified before so that he can have a fair trial.
Was the ICTR able to deliver justice?
Yes, yes. Oh, no, I say that without any hesitation we did, because we tried, and all those who were most responsible for the genocide, most of them were tried. Of course, there are a few who are at large, and that's why the mechanism was formed. And then, apart from that, we went all out, the outreach program, trying to get reconciliation and so forth. It wasn't only justice. We also tried to reconcile the people who are dead now, those who suffered most, the victims of the genocide. So we did render justice to Rwanda. And ICTR is very respected in the international community because of the jurisprudence that was principles that we brought here, rape as a accusation case. You know, we even went further than that, media now, to the media case. And one that people don't speak about, which I was a member of that panel, is the Bikini case, where we held that the lyrics of music could also incite genocide. And that was a very interesting trial. Let me share it with you, because since the man was a composer, he wasn't even in the country when the genocide started. But his music was being used by the journalists, who after playing it will make some comments asking people whether they want to go back in the pre-independence era where the minority Tutsis controlled the majority Hutus. And then he himself wasn't there, but unfortunately for him, when he came, he too went around now and, you know, started campaigning and talking. Otherwise, he wouldn't have been found guilty. And I say it's an interesting trial because we had two witnesses who came, and when they gave their evidence, they sang some of the songs. And then to provide humor to the whole thing, one of the interpreters, a Cameroonian like myself, who was in the English booth, we were waiting for him to translate what the witness had said. And then he burst into song and started singing. So that was very funny. And the whole trial chambers, you know, it lightened the atmosphere. And I found out that when I was in my domestic jurisdiction, I found that in court, lies come in all shapes and sizes. But I never thought that at the level of international justice, people can really come there and tell lies. But when I was, the 9 years that I spent here, I found that not only do some witnesses come and tell outright lies, but there are also lawyers who try to misquote the evidence that has been given by a witness. And I was noted for always trying to tell the lawyer, I said, no, counsel, I'm sure you are mistaken. This is not what the witness said. And I quote verbatim what the witness said. And then we had this case of somebody, I'm a Catholic, so when I came here and I heard that even Catholic priests and Reverend sisters were involved in the genocide, I was really concerned. So one day we were doing the trial of a priest, Munyakazi, and a witness came to court and testified that he not only heard, but he saw this priest take a gun. The priest was a young man, about 30-something at that time, he was in his 40s during the trial, but at the time of the genocide, he couldn't have been more than 35 years old. He said he saw him pick up a gun and shoot a 73-year-old priest. And if that wasn't bad enough, he also took a dagger, and the aunt of the priest who was staying in one little room there, that young priest took it and stabbed that woman 5 times. I tell you, I couldn't sleep that night. I was so worried. I looked at this young priest. What could have gotten into his head to kill another priest? Is it that he didn't study his own theology well or what? Anyway, at the end of the day, I said, well, I'm sure I'm going to listen to worse stories than this. So I calmed down. And then another priest came, still a witness for the prosecution, and gave testimony that that particular priest that one said was killed by this young one was in his orphanage when the militia came and then got him out and shot him in his own presence. And that old lady too was in the orphanage. So I was so angry. I turned to my colleagues, what do we do with a witness like this? He said, well, George Arrey, it happens like that here. So, you know, I was really, after that, I became very alert to listen. I looked at the witnesses well, who is telling a lie and who is telling the truth. So I was very shocked to see that somebody could tell a lie against a priest. And then, we had very serious moments in court where witnesses will break down when they are talking about their experiences. And when this happens, when I'm sitting with two male judges, they will say, Judge, I really do something. I'll turn to the witness and say, you see, we do have that mug in front of you. There is a glass there. Could you just have a glass of water? And if you think that you cannot continue, just tell the court we can take a little break for you to come back. And then I got into the habit of starting even when they start the case, because I saw that some witnesses were so traumatized that they thought that everybody in court was against them when you ask questions. So I always start by saying, witness X, Y, Z, thank you for coming. We weren't there in Rwanda. The only way we can do our work and arrive at the truth is for you to tell us what happened. And in the course of telling us, you'll be questioned by the two sides, the prosecution and the defense. The defense counsel doesn't have anything against you. He's only doing his work. So please, just answer the questions. And they say, thank you. And I noticed that relaxed them. Because before that, we used to have witnesses where when the defense says, witness, what happened, this, are you sure you were there? They will get angry. Okay, so since you were there, I'm telling you, like, tell the court what happened. Are you saying that you were there? Tell the court what happened. You know, they just get annoyed. So that was the only way we could calm them down. And we've had some very, very intelligent witnesses too, and very funny defense counsels. There was a day we had a witness who gave very good testimony. And I turned and looked at my colleagues. We were like, how? I don't envy defense counsel. How is he going to break down this evidence? The defense counsel was a professor from the United States of America. So we turned to him and said, Professor X, is there time to cross-examine? He stood up. He looked at the witness. Witness X, Y, were you there? Withdrawn. Did you see the witness? Withdrawn. Can you tell the court withdrawn? Now, answer the question. He had not asked any question, so all of us were perplexed whilst we were waiting for so we looked, the witness turned, looked at the bench, turned and looked at the defense counsel, said, withdraw. Now you can ask your question. The whole court was amused and everybody started laughing. So at the end of the day, we asked counsel, counsel, what happened? He said, you know, when the witness was talking, I was like in Rwanda. So when I wanted to ask the question, I started and I just couldn't finish the question. But I thought I had asked the question. So I was surprised he didn't answer. So you see, we had those light moments in court too. But all in all, I was very, very happy to be part of the team that said no, 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 no to impunity. Because when we were reading about the genocide in my country, it didn't give it the same meaning as coming here and listening to people who lived that genocide. And then when we went for locals' visits, it just, you know, gave the reality to what the people were saying. When we saw all those skeletons and so forth. So all in all, I really enjoyed being in this tribunal. And the jurisprudence that was made in this tribunal is now forms part of international humanitarian law. So I'm happy and humbled that I was part of that team. I am just surprised. I don't know what happened. As we said, I usually say that it was a 100 day of madness when the devil took over control of Rwanda. Otherwise, I can't see how, you know, Christians, Muslims, and everybody, somebody you were eating in the same place today, the next day you came, brought the ability to kill. So I don't know. I was disappointed because before I came here, I expected that the hierarchy of the church should come out strongly and say we condemn whatever happened in Rwanda. But I was later told that they did, but I didn't hear. And anyway, that particular priest that I was talking about was discharged and acquitted. That's the only person in all the cases that I did here who was discharged and acquitted because there was no evidence against him. So he went, I think he went back to Rome or so. I think he's in Rome now. He was discharged and acquitted. And it hasn't affected my faith. It's just that at first I was really traumatized. But there are lots of horrible things happening now in the world. So where do you start? If my own country, we had always had a very peaceful country in Cameroon. Now Boko Haram doesn't allow us to have any peace. All because we share a border with Nigeria. So where are we going to? So that is the thing. So when we're talking about international justice, what do we do when they're arrested? The few that are arrested, what do? Do we try them in our own country? Or where do we send them? Because even Nigeria doesn't want to see them. They are fighting with them. So that's the problem that I think. But when I stayed here, it made me realize that there is no price to peace. Peace is very essential in the world. Because we're taking the peace that we had in our own country for granted. But after serving here for 9 years, I actually appreciated the fact that my country was a peaceful country. So I think that it's essential. The lessons that we taught to other people that no, 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 they should always say no. We hope there will be no genocide in the world. Well, we see a lot of things happening in some other parts of the world now that you can even say are genocide. So we did our own job, but it seems that at least Rwanda learned the lesson, but have the other countries learned that same lesson? That is the question.